is a darkness upon the land. A savior is needed.
Who are you?
The man who'll kill Dracula.
When Netflix said they were going to do a TV show, I was like, oh god, here we go. This is not going to go well. I was blown away. And as a Castlevania fan, I think they've done a fantastic job. And I cannot recommend this anime enough to you. But let's go into why. Let's speak about why. The Netflix show is an outstanding portrayal of the series characters' lore and packaged in an amazing animated showpiece. There are 4 seasons, but it's not really balanced on how many episodes there are per season. There's like 4 episodes in the first season, and then it spreads into more of a kind of a normal 12 to 16 later on and stuff. But in reality, there's 32 episodes in total for this block. It does feel more like a season 1 and maybe like a season 2 to sort of catch all the content though, so like 2 seasons rather than 4. The story covers Dracula and his wife, who tries to show him the beauty of man. Ironic then that the ugliest of men believe that she is a witch and label her as such and burn her at the stake. Causing Dracula to become enraged and damn man on Earth for eternity. And it's this curse that calls upon Trevor Belmont, the last of the famous bounty hunters out of exile, to do something about it. He was exiled by the same people who murdered Dracula's wife, and after his family was no longer needed, the Belmonts, to fight back their enemies, they just washed their hands of him. So it's kind of interesting, that sort of dynamic as the series goes on. Trevor is a dry-humoured, unwanting-to-be hero. His conscience won't let him walk away from doing the right thing. And I love that about his character. That is proper Trevor and how he's portrayed in... And I'll talk about that more, but how he's portrayed in those few little pages that you get and then all the lore afterwards. He doesn't want to do this, but he's like, he can't... His conscience just won't let him walk away, even though that's what he should do. Because... you know, how badly the world has treated him. He later meets with Cypher, who's a powerful magic user, who does a great job matching Trevor in witty comebacks and banter between the two of them, and has probably some of the show's most impressive visuals when she's doing her magic. Her powers are very impressive when she pulls off anything in the show. And finally, Alucard, a series favourite, who's the son of Dracula, if you don't know, completes the group of misfits between the three with his impressive vampire powers, turning into different weapons, levitating swords and all kinds of stuff like that. He's the superhuman and does all the kind of cool flipping through the stuff, as you just saw there, where he became a wolf and jumped through fire. The three of them take on Dracula's armies in some amazingly stylish fight scenes, as you can see from the trailer I've got here. Speed and magic is animated superbly in this show, with Trevor especially doing some amazing things with his whip that I often had to pause, rewind and say, is that possible? That was just too cool. Is that even humanly possible to do with a whip? The best part of for me was how much of a perfect intro it is to Castlevania. So if you've never played any of the games, you can start here. And then this will give you enough context to go into the games and go, okay, I know what Castlevania is all about. I know what the history of Dracula, why he's to be feared. Whereas if you just play a game, you don't see Dracula to the very end. And you don't, you know, unless you are compelled by what Castlevania did, like I would when I was a kid, you might play and go, I don't really see what the fuss is about. But with all the lore behind it, if you're looking for a story, then this is a good way to sort of build that lore and go, okay, I know why I'm a Belmont or whatever. And I know why I'm going into this castle to try and stop Dracula and kind of put it all together. The transformation of what they've managed to take from this few paragraphs that they had in the instruction manuals of these games and build it up into a full-blown story is excellent. It's amazingly crafted. And it's just brilliant, Castlevania. It's like how I would dream and writing it if I ever had the talent to do it myself. Watching Trevor use his whip and explode demons and utilize the items that he often finds in the games is a joy and makes you think why on earth Castlevania isn't as big now as it was back in the 80s. And especially again with things like the magic and the transformations and all of that, what they could actually do with it if they gave it more time as well with the franchise. One of my absolute favourite animes of all time now, and it's just been hinted that there will be a fifth season, which will cover the adventures of Richter Belmont, which is much, much later in the timeline, and some of the best games in the series star Richter as well. So I say, go watch it now. You won't be disappointed. And after that, go and play some of the games, because they're fun too. And they're not as hard as they used to be, because a lot of the collections of Castlevania stuff now come with an easy mode, so you don't have to worry about that. But the best thing about this is it's now completed its fourth season, and it's almost wrapped up in this is the end of the arc of Castlevania 3. So the reason I'm talking about it now is because it's a good time to sort of, if you wanted to binge watch it all and you didn't want to wait for the next season to come out, you could binge watch these four seasons of Castlevania and then it's complete. And then when the fifth season comes out, if it does come out, when it stars Richter Belmont, there's no way, apart from maybe Alucard and Dracula of course, that there would be necessarily as many drawbacks to the original one. You could literally watch these four seasons and be done with it if you wanted to. It is a great time to sort of pick it up and give it a go. I'm not going to say that, you know, I'm not going to get in conversation about whether hard games and difficult games and all that is a good thing, bad thing. That's for another time. I think we've even covered it on the show once. However, that did build the notoriety of Castlevania, where only the grown-ups could play it on the NES. But as the series has gone on, maybe that's the reason it fell into the obscurity, because it's definitely one of the biggest contributors to NES hard, you know, Nintendo original hard. But now you don't have to worry about that. You can enjoy these classic video games with the Castlevania collection, and you can play it either with save states on the original European release, or go and play the original intended Japanese version, which has an easy, normal, and hard mode, and you can actually enjoy them. So don't get scared off, there are options nowadays. Right, like I said, I told you I was going to gush about Castlevania, but we're talking about anime, so let's get back to the anime, shall we? Let's go to the scorecard for Castlevania. So what we got? The commitment is 32 episodes, still medium for me. I think when you start getting to 50 episodes, I would rank that up to a higher commitment rate, but that's about right. 32 episodes is still a medium commitment, so not too bad, not too short, not too long. But there is apparently more coming, like I said, with season 5. So in between Castlevania games, when Dracula rises again, there's generally about a 100-year gap. So if you are going to watch these four seasons and then think, oh, crimes, if they can still make them, I'm going to wait until they release them all, there's going to be a 100-year gap now. If they, you know, they've followed the lore up till now, I'd find it very strange that they didn't. But there'll be a 100-year gap before it all starts, you know, with Richter and things. So you can watch this and be content with the four seasons. So I'd highly recommend that just to enjoy it what it is, and then maybe wait again for the next 2-3 seasons for them to finish Belmont's arc, if that's how you like to watch your anime. You will feel like you've watched Castlevania 1 and you're waiting for Castlevania 2, the Netflix show in here. Also, stop doing that. I appreciate that sometimes you might want to wait and watch the whole thing through, but there's a lot of my favourite shows that have been cancelled because people go, do you know what? I'll wait until they're all on DVD, or I'll wait until all the series is done, and then I'll watch them all the way through. The only problem with that is that you're not watching it and giving it ratings at the time of when it's released, so that means that a lot of things get cancelled. Evil Dead is a perfect example of that. Now, I know things nowadays can be supported by Netflix and stuff, and it's not so much of a problem, fair enough, but when it is a show that's dependent by ratings, then please watch it with me, because I don't want things to be cancelled, and they tend to be really cool. Moving on to pace, there's a little bit of a caveat with this. There's a little bit of a slump in season 3, where it slows right down. And even I, myself, as a massive Castlevania fan, was kind of like, oh god, they've kind of lost all of their momentum. Season 1 and 2, I thought, was very kind of, yeah, we'll get straight to the point. What are they going to do next? What move is Trevor going to do next? What item is he going to use? Wow, Cypher is using all these spells. Alucard's really cool. Dracula's got interesting because he's very three-dimensional and he's not just the big bad guy that he could have been in this, where it's just like, yeah, I'm Dracula, come and kill me. He's actually three-dimensional. You kind of feel for him and sometimes cheer him on. All the enemies have got all these backstories, so it moves very, very quickly. And then it goes into season 3, where they've kind of moved on to the next part in the story, and they introduce new characters, and they're building foundations again. Now, that's not a problem, but it does slow the pace down once they introduce all these new story arcs and build up all this foundation. When you've already got three really cool characters and Dracula as the bad guy, they start giving you new characters, you're kind of like, yeah, but they're not as cool as these guys, so why are we wasting time on them? So that does... There is a bit in season 3 where you might have to gut through it. Some of you might think, what you're talking about, Bill, it was really consistent all the way through. But for me, it was very kind of like, oh, I just wanted to pick up the pace a little bit. But season 3 ends phenomenally. It blew me away. I thought the ending of season 3 was fantastic. So it is well worth it in the end. And season 4, again, they fix it. They don't have the same problem again. Season 4 is consistent throughout. Fans of the games will be looking forward to watch what monster they pull out of the huge repertoire of monsters in Castlevania. So, you know, what boss are they going to use next? What enemy are they going to portray? What character are they going to pull out of the game itself? Or rather, what weapon they're going to use? You know, like I've mentioned before, what spell is going to be cast? Or in some cases, what music track are they going to use? Yeah! When there's a particular part where the kid in me just got really excited, the nostalgia version of me always waits for it, where you just want them to use some of the video game music, and there's many things they don't do in video. When they put a video game on the big screen, they don't always pay homage to the music, but Castlevania's music is some of the best in video game history, in my opinion. And they do pay homage to the music from time to time. So yeah, very happy with that. When that music hit, I was like, that's it. This has got to be one of my favorite animes of all time. It's just can't not be. So yeah, the music, the weapons, the characters, love it all. Well done. As for the animation, it's gorgeous. It's masterful. It's outstanding and it's consistent. Never looks bad. It never loses its quality throughout the whole thing, and that's what I normally worry about with these kind of animes. The first season looks really good, and then as the seasons go on, they either lose budget or time, or they need to turn it over faster or whatever, and the quality drops. But it doesn't on this. It stays consistent throughout, and it's always good. Always good. The character design can vary, though. And I'm being really picky here. I'm being, just so I don't go gushing too much about this show, I'm being really picky. When you look at some of the characters in the video games and how they're drawn, and I know they're stills, so you can take a lot more time over them, some of the character designs are a little plain. But like I said, I'm being really picky here. I didn't want to give too many excellence and people go, oh yeah, Bill, you're just getting gushy because it's Castlevania and you're Mark. I wanted to be as level as I could with you. And you might look at a few characters and go, yeah, I don't see the big deals. When the thing is moving, when the characters are moving around and Trevor's spinning that whip around and Cypher's using those magic spells, oh my god, it's phenomenal. There was a show that I covered, or rather a movie I covered on Animania, the first season I did, which was Sword of the Stranger. And I mentioned that in the closing sections of Sword of the Stranger is one of the best fighting scenes I've ever seen in animation, where every frame of animation is added, even the ones that you don't think they would have ever bothered with. Where generally in this kind of style, they'll gloss over a few animations, you know, just to speed things up and give you the impression of what's happening. But no, they actually go into every kind of movement of every joint and spin of the whip in this, which is the biggest thing, where, you know, Trevor like spins it around with his forearm, and you could see every little bit of the whip. They could have just gone, you know, just done a circle and moved two frames of animation until it's around his hand. But no, you see every little part of the whip go around his hand, in snatching arrows out of the air and stuff like that. It's gory. Some of it is quite gut-wrenching, really. But and you see every frame of it. But yeah, it's truly a masterpiece to see it moving. Voice acting. Richard Armitage, who is the voice of Trevor, would win this excellent award that I've given it here on his own through just of his portrayal of Trevor. Because he is so funny. His mannerisms are so good. You can hear when he tuts. You can hear when he sighs. And he does it in such a way that just is beautifully portrayed with the character when it's moving on screen. But it's not just him. You've also got James Callis and Alejandra Reynosa doing equally as good jobs with Alucard and Cypher. All of it is just stellar. The three of them and the chemistry they have when they talk to one another, it's almost like they're real people. And you can tell that they must have been in the sound booth as together, bouncing off each other, because it just works, and it works so well. And you can tell I care about this that much, because I've actually gone to the trouble of naming them on this show, and I don't often do that. I've actually gone to call them out, because they do such a fantastic job on those voices. You three are phenomenal when it comes to this, and you had me hanging on every portrayal of the words that you use for these characters. Thank you so much for bringing life to these characters I've enjoyed for so long. Banter is on point, the chemistry is perfect, as I mentioned. Every character's voice is strong. I don't think there's a single bad voice actor or actress in the whole thing. I think they're all really well done and very unique in the way that they sound. However, there are a couple of accents which they're not bad, in my opinion. I've heard a lot worse, but I often ask the question why. Because some characters, even though they are born or come from the same area, are not doing that accent. So why have you decided to do that accent? And I had a bit of a question mark over that. Didn't make the voice acting any less. It's just it made me go, well, you're putting on a Transylvanian accent, and these guys aren't. Why? I don't get that. Finally, the ending. Excellent again. And I'll tell you why. Because of when I've chosen to speak to you about it. The end of season 4 wraps up everything beautifully. You don't think as you're watching it, it's like, how could they possibly do that? How could they make all this end in a perfect way and sort of set things up still for the next one, but not get too carried away or leave gaping holes or just rush the ending? But they do. They pull it off. And I think it's brilliant. It feels just like a Castlevania ending, like it should. But it still brings a lot of gravitas to it, where it doesn't get too silly. So I think they nailed the landing perfectly. No complaints here. And like I said, it doesn't feel possible. When it all gets serious, they still manage to keep that banter. Not too much through what Marvel gets criticised for a lot at the moment, where you know there's all those clever the clever quips that they have that maybe pull you out of the dangerous at the moment. It doesn't get that kind of style, but there's enough humour in there when things are getting down and dreary, and when Castlevania could potentially fall into the realms of plodding or God, this is depressing. They do enough to sort of raise people's spirits, and they feel human when they do it. So they especially do that with the ending as well. Every character had their time in the spotlight. Every character was portrayed well. Then none of them overstayed their welcome or went on for too long. I'm happy with the fact that they now finished those story arcs and they're moving on to new characters. I'm not going to miss those characters, because I think that's it. You've done what you needed to do. That we're ready for something new, which I think when an anime makes you feel that way, I think it's done a good job in its ending. And finally, I truly feel that you're watching something epic. See that castle collapse and the sun come up, it gives you the same feeling as the games do, that you've achieved something or you've been a part of something epic. And I think that's outstanding that they managed to also deliver on that same message. It made me instantly finish the series and want to play all the Castlevania games. What better ending is that?